Contradictory to what usually it is that say pancreas, we don't have histological diagnosis. In any case, you are going to operate, go ahead and operate and do a pancreatic adenectomy if your mortality is less than 5% or less than 3%. But in many centers, routinely, I have reviewed it and I was also surprised that they are doing it. So for any curative resection, if you want to do, probably histology is required. Because suppose you can't do it for in patient in which surgery is the same for benign or malignancy, maybe you may not. But otherwise, majority of the center, or when you have explored, probably you are having a frozen section for that, and then you can identify and you can go ahead and do a curative resection or whatever. As far as endoluminal is concerned, that like you are suspecting cholangiocarcinoma, you do a RCP and can take a breast cytology. Laparoscopic ultrasound is also available that you can prep. Any malignancy, you put a laparoscopic first, you like laparoscopic staging. The idea of laparoscopic staging is that you have to identify the tumor in which it is either down stage or up stage in vis-a-vis radiological investigation, that is ultrasound, CT or MRI, whatever you have done. So, I mean, what is the, like more than 10% upgraded, you are there for laparoscopy. If there is not a significant difference, there is no point in doing for laparoscopic diagnosis. But as far as histological diagnosis, and if you want to give chemotherapy or radiotherapy, you need a histological diagnosis. Without that, you cannot give. So either you take it laparoscopically, or when you have operated, you found it to be unresectable, you take a sample and send it for histopathology so as to give radiotherapy or other form of treatment. So if you review the recent literature, majority of the center, answer for histopathological diagnosis is yes. You do either ultrasound or CT guided. But only thing arises when, if it is negative, what is next? Positive, perfectly valued, but negative, and all the radiological investigation are suggesting malignancy, clinical feature, history, examination, and your results of surgery are perfectly all right, matching with the world, and there is no harm in going for a definitive surgery on these patients, which will happen in a very few number of patients, very few percentage, I must say, 2 to 3%, if you are adding up all these scenario in a clinical situation of a patient. With a reasonable certainty, you can make the diagnosis of malignancy, basically. Is this all right, sir?
Well, I agree with you, and I would like to say that there are two set of situations. One is a definitive set of situation, and other is a equivocal situation. In a definitive situation, where clinical appraisal of the patient and your basic investigations are matching, and you do not have any uncertainty about the diagnosis, that you have done a CT scan and you found a solid enhancing lesion in the head of the pancreas. It's a 60-year-old gentleman with progressive jaundice. Well, in this context, there is no point going in for histological confirmation. As you have rightly said yourself, that if diagnosis comes out positive on fine needle aspiration cytology, it helps. But if it comes out negative, then we are nowhere, because we can't leave it as that. And, when one is equipped to do Whipple's operation at that level of mortality, which is less than 5% worldwide, then one should be able to even manage one case of chronic pancreatitis if it were to present in a rather quixotic manner. So that is one point. Second is that, yes, if there is any equivocation about the diagnosis, if the diagnosis is not matching with your clinical history, then one has to go whole hog to have a histological diagnosis, whether it is by CT guided, whether it is by endoluminal ultrasound guidance, or by ERCP and by papillotomy and getting a breast cytology, either which way one should. And I would strongly agree with Dr. P. N. Agarwal when he says that if you are giving a chemotherapy to a patient, if you are giving radiotherapy to a patient, and if you have designated this to be a metastatic disease, you must always have a histological proof, whether it is in the setting of a cytology or it is in the setting of a biopsy, proper biopsy. One will not leave a patient as an end stage malignancy without proving the diagnosis. So I think that goes without saying that one has to go whole hog to prove this diagnosis. Dr. Jain, you have any comments to make?
I agree with you. If I think that the patient is resectable, and if there is a space occupying lesion in the head of the pancreas, and the patient has got obstructive jaundice, it is better to resect. And if I am labeling the patient and that is a terminal patient and referring for chemotherapy colleague, then I would like to have a tissue diagnosis.
Absolutely. Yes, any other aspect that you would like to know?
One more question. Alkaline phosphatase is a pivotal investigation obstructive jaundice.
Yeah.
And since there are many isomers, so till now we haven't gone for an isoenzyme which is specific for biliary tract. Do we require this isoenzyme, or since we have mentioned that ALP can be from the origin of from bone origin also, or from biliary origin also? So is it important to go for an isoenzyme, or is it sufficient to just?
You see, as far as isoenzymes are concerned, probably we do not have given much weightage to this aspect, because clinical context of obstructive jaundice and alkaline phosphatase, it is considered that it is a phenomena because of the obstruction. As Dr. P. N. Agarwal has very rightly said, that there are two parts of the liver, this alkaline phosphatase. One is an excretory one, and the second is also the basic production by the canaliculi. For example, in certain patients, and I think we need to talk a little more about it, in certain patients of metastatic involvement of liver because of some non-hepatobiliary condition, like CA of the breast settling down in the liver, and patient is not having jaundice, and you do alkaline phosphatase, it is a very good investigation for picking up metastasis, you know. Now, this is what? It is an irritative phenomena of... irritative phenomena of biliary canaliculi, wherein this causes irritation to the canaliculi, and there is more outpouring of the alkaline phosphatase. And 5-nucleotidase helps us in deciding which is the, so whether it is coming from the liver or it is outside the liver. If the two are raised, it has to be from the 5-nucleotidase. But in the context of an obstructive jaundice, alkaline phosphatase is another very important purpose also, and that is that it is a very sensitive investigation, though it has a lag time. When the obstruction becomes better, this is the investigation which takes a little longer to settle down, but its serial levels are going to tell you that whatever you have done for the patient, whether it is stenting or whether it is biliointestinal bypass, whether that's working or not. Short of what Dr. P. N. Agarwal has said, very rightly, I agree with him, that the mainstay of assessing the stoma, however, is a radionuclide study. But before that, you know, if you find that alkaline phosphatase is also responding, so that may be one way of looking at it, okay, that other parameters will take a little longer to settle down, but it is settling down all the right.
If alkaline phosphatase is raised in combination with gamma GGT or 5-nucleotidase, it is almost certain that it is hepatic origin. But suppose if you don't have a facility in that lab, that estimation of 5-nucleotidase or gamma GGT, then you can go ask for electrophoresis or isoenzyme. Or other thing is that it heat stable or heat labile, because hepatic origin alkaline phosphatase is heat labile, and alkaline phosphatase of bone origin is heat stable. These used to be the older test, but with the availability of this gamma GGT and 5-nucleotidase, as Dr. Agarwal has told, there is no need of doing this electrophoresis or.
And another thing is this, everything should be seen in the clinical context. I mean, what patient you are dealing and what investigation you have ordered. It is not just an isolation alkaline phosphatase. You have to see the whole context of the patient, then you apply this investigation. There are battery of investigation. I have already, in the beginning, hundreds of investigations are available. But what you are doing, which is in that clinical context, which are useful for the patient, you reach to some conclusion and you change up your management or diagnosis. It is not that just investigations are available, you are ordering. Many are available, hundreds are available.
I think you have.
But you do whatever is reasonable and helps in the management of the patient overall.
I think you have really very well summarized it, that every investigation and any investigation that you do must serve the purpose of either settling the diagnosis or helping us in the management. Any diagnostic test done in isolation has no meaning. So whenever you order an investigation, it should be cost effective, you should reach the diagnosis as quickly as possible, and you should reach the diagnosis beyond a shadow of doubt, and this should help you in the management of the case. This is the aspect which we'll cover in the third part of this symposium. Thank you very much.